is 392 Boulevard. This is where I'm at. 392 Boulevard. My grandma lived over here when I first moved in with her, 1996. First exposure to the inner city of Atlanta. Of course, I had grew up in East Lake Meadows. My earlier years, like ages like 1 to 3, grew up in East Lake Meadows. But this was, that was East Atlanta. But coming, moving here in 1996 when I was 7, that was like my first real exposure to the city of Atlanta.
Bedford Pines was first developed in 1928 and is considered to be one of the first affordable housing communities located in the heart of Atlanta's old Fourth Ward district. The village of Bedford Pines is a 157-unit affordable housing community in the heart of Atlanta Section A, Project-Based Rental Assistance, PBRA. The Bedford Pine Apartments along Parkway Drive and Boulevard are a project-based form of subsidized housing. It's only signing up for 5 more years of subsidies. This means in order to initiate this multi-phase project, Wingate companies will work with their lawyers to structure the transaction and obtain HUD approvals necessary to demolish existing Bedford Pine buildings and replace them with new construction, 100% Section A senior project-based with amenities. C.W. Hill opened in 1883 and was first named Calhoun Grammar School, then the Opportunity School. This school was originally located at 417 Piedmont Avenue. In 1947, the school name changed to Charles Walter Hill Elementary and was relocated to 386 Pine Street Northeast in 1967.
Me and your auntie used to walk to come out that way, come down that little stuff, and then we would walk this way. And it was always like, you know, you homeless people in the park, but you know, they didn't mess with you. Even one time, Bill Campbell, he came and walked us through school. The old mayor of Atlanta, he came and he walked us to school.
Central Park is a 17.37-acre park in the Fourth Ward West neighborhood of the old Fourth Ward in Atlanta, Georgia. It was known as Bedford Pine Park prior to 1999. The open space was created as a result of the City of Atlanta urban renewal in the 1960s. The history behind this 50-plus-year-old bridge is that it was fought for by the people. The implications of the Federal Aid Highway Act of 1956 led to mass deconstruction of urban housing. In Georgia, the Department of Transportation planned to have Interstate 75 run right through some historically African-American neighborhoods like Old Fourth Ward and Sweet Arbor.
So this is my old middle school. Due to gentrification, they closed down and it turned into another school water and complex. So this is what we left with. It used to be some apartments across the street. This is the gardens. It used to be across the street. They got closed down. This garden used to be on this side. This garden used to be on the other side. But due to gentrification and the city of Atlanta, the great city of Atlanta, you know, during the 1996 Olympics, you know, before they came to Atlanta, they planned on getting rid of all subsidized government housing and basically gentrifying the city of Atlanta, the inner city. So basically, it was a mixture of white flight and the city wanting to actually generate tax revenues from the citizens because most people weren't really generating any taxes for the city. They were costing the city money to save, I guess, but they still make money off of the poverty-stricken, the lower income class. They still make money off of us living in red light districts, mass incarceration, all these things funnel the criminal justice system. So it kept a lot of people on top. It built a lot of people's careers that are in power to this day. But this is my old look for. I went here 6th grade through 8th grade, and this is what we look at when it's important.
You spent 9 months at this school. This is where I got my most exposure to different types of people from diverse backgrounds. Grady was like one of the most historic schools, one of the oldest historic schools in Atlanta. They used to be an all-boys school. Then it got integrated to boys and girls, and then black people got integrated into the school system in the early 70s. And then they changed the name of the school recently. I think maybe 2 to 3 years ago, they changed the name.
blessed and still living, trying to earn every penny that I'm getting.
The legend is that Grady Hyde was named after a racist. Human race. They said that he was a racist for the amount of prostitution and he was biased, so I guess they wanted to change the name, but we still got Grady Hyde for that's why I was born.
Phase 1. To initiate this multi-phase project, Wingate companies work with their lawyers to structure this transaction to obtain HUD approvals necessary to demolish the existing Bedford Pine buildings and replace them with new construction. 100% Section A, senior project phase with full amenities. Phase 2. Station 464 was the second phase of the redevelopment. As with City Lights, 8AO helped structure the transaction to facilitate the demolition of Bedford Pine buildings so that they could be replaced with new construction, a 96-unit building. Phase 3 project outcomes will include complex redevelopment addressing long-term affordability and housing. According to Wingate Management, the original community's low-density housing no longer met the needs of the neighborhood. Through its work with HUD, HAO helped with Wingate make its redevelopment possible. Wingate will continue with its redevelopment plan until all existing Section A housing is replaced in new construction buildings. The L44 is renowned for being home to the Dr. King Center. The center was founded in 1968 by Coretta Scott King, who started the organization in the basement of the couple's home in the year following the 1968 assassination of her husband, Martin Luther King Jr. In 1981, the center's headquarters were moved into the Martin Luther King Jr. National Historic Park facility on Auburn Avenue, which includes King's birth home and the Ebenezer Baptist Church, where he preached from 1960 until his death in 1968. The Sweet Auburn Historic District is a historic African-American neighborhood along and surrounding Auburn Avenue, east of downtown Atlanta, Georgia. The name Sweet Auburn was coined by John Wesley Dobbs, referring to the richest Negro street in the world, one of the largest concentrations of African-American businesses in the United States. The rise of Auburn Avenue as the Black Business District in Atlanta was to a great extent an outcome of the 1906 Atlanta race riots. Prior to this time, Black businesses operated largely in downtown Atlanta, a business district integrated as far as business ownership was concerned. In the great words of the great Dr. Maya Angelou, you can't really know where you're going until you know where you've been. This was my favorite building ever since I came to call the old Fort my home. Ever since I came to call the village of Pine my home, this was my favorite building. I always seen it from afar and knew I could make it out. It's bittersweet that the neighborhood is, you know, less violent, has more opportunities, but the sad part is none of these things were able to exist when we were here, but we still had a sense of community that once existed, but it probably won't be here in the next 5 to 10 years. I probably won't be able to recognize anything, so I wanted to capture these few moments with my daughter.
So all in all, I would say that the gentrification is bittersweet to me. Like, it's bittersweet because it's bitter because, you know, there still was a community that existed. We still had camaraderie. People still looked out for each other back in the time periods when I was growing up in the 90s and the 2000s, early 2000s. It still had a sense of community, and it's like the bad apples shouldn't outweigh the good apples. They shouldn't make it hard for the good apples. So gentrification kind of eradicated pretty much everybody, where only like maybe 10 to 12, maybe even 15% of the population of the old residents were able to actually move back to the community and be able to afford the actual income. So it's like when you get rid of subsidized housing, when you get rid of a lower class group of people from the area, you're not getting rid of the problem. You're just right. You're getting rid of the people, and you're getting rid of the eyesore, the image of it. So it's like we gotta start from the bottom in this country, and you know, start from the ground level, and give people resources that will last them, that they can utilize and survive off of, not just one-time things that are gonna be temporary. Growing up in Fort Worth, growing up in that kind of apartment, if I had to do it all over again, I wouldn't change anything because my circumstances is what made me who I am. Even though we knew we was in this environment, we knew we was of a lower class, we knew we was growing up in poverty, it didn't change how we saw our future. We still were optimistic about our future, and we knew that we could make it out with those circumstances. So it kind of motivated me to want more out of life, you know,
But you know, I ended up still, you know, conceiving you my last year in high school. But I wanted to show you how I still made it out despite all my circumstances.
Something never changed.